Ready?
Right. Yeah. Good evening, everybody. Welcome to this evening episode of Persu. This is Persu 15R, which is Hematology Erythrocytic Disorder. We are streaming live from GMCH Chandigarh via Kolkata. We have a very interesting topic today, which is fragmentation hemolytic anemia, which we quite often see. And if we do not realize, we may many often miss it. And to talk on that, we have somebody very young, vibrant, and very intelligent, Dr. Ankita Garg. She is an MBBS from MMI, MSR, Mullah Ambala, a best graduate and a gold medalist. She is an MD pathology from the famous GMC at Chandigarh, where she is right now as a demonstrator in the Department of Pathology with multiple publications in national and international journals with interest in hematology, cytopathology and surgical pathology. Before I ask Dr. Garg to start, let me request all of you to please keep your mic muted, your camera off, and please do not share your screen. With this, let me request Dr. Ankita Garg, ma'am, please share your screen and let's start. Yes, sir. Good evening, everyone. I am Dr. Ankita Garg, demonstrator, Government Medical College and Hospital, Chandigarh. Today, I am here to speak on the topic of fragmentation hemolytic anemias. Before I begin, I would like to thank Dr. Nadeem, sir, and Dr. Anita Tahilan for giving me this opportunity. And it is an absolute pleasure to be here with you people tonight. So just to introduce the topic, fragmentation hemolytic anemias are a diverse group of anemias that are caused by turbulence, cleavage or abrasion of red cells leading to the formation of schistocytes. And since I already said it's a diverse group and there are many causes, which include macroangiopathic hemolytic anemia, which is associated with abnormalities of the heart or great vessels, and microangiopathic hemolytic anemia, which is associated with small vessel diseases. So first of all, the macroangiopathic hemolytic anemias, they are basically caused predominantly due to some valvular defects like an synthetic valvular prosthesis or valvular homografts or some unoperated valve disease, and in some cases diseases of the great vessels such as coarctation of aorta. So basically these valves create turbulence and they cause fragmentation of the red cells. Then we have the microangiopathic hemolytic anemias, which is again a much more diverse group than the macroangiopathic ones. And today we will be mainly focusing on these causes. First of all, there is the TTP-HUS syndrome and its related disorder. Then there are distinct pregnancy and postpartum period related microangiopathic hemolytic anemias, which include HELLP syndrome and TTP-HUS related with pregnancy. Other causes include malignant hypertension, DIC, few immune mechanisms such as lupus, scleroderma, and then there are few miscellaneous causes such as hemangiomas and a distinct entity, March hemoglobinuria. So you have a hemogram in your emergency. What will you look for and when will you suspect a fragmentation hemolytic anemia? So obviously there will be anemia. The TLC may be normal or increased depending upon the underlying etiology. And thrombocytopenia is there. That also depends on the underlying etiology. I would be focusing on this point later on in the talk. And reticulocytosis. Reticulocytosis we have to specifically look for. And the flags on automated cell counter can prompt us to do a peripheral blood smear evaluation. So always look at your flags very carefully. The peripheral blood smear can show a normocytic normochromic anemia or anisocytosis, particularly macrocytosis can be there, variable number of fragmented cells that are schistocytes. Other clues that you can see on your peripheral blood are polychromasia, basophilic stippling and circulating nucleated RBCs. So what exactly is a schistocyte and how do we quantify this? So to eliminate the inter-observer variability in the identification and quantification of these cells, the schistocyte working group of ICSH has certain recommendations that I would be focusing on in the first few slides. So they have characteristic morphology. They are smaller than intact red cells. They can be triangular in shape. Let me just turn on my pointer. Yeah, so here we can see in this B picture, this triangular type of schistocyte. They can be microcrescents, helmet cells, keratocytes, and also microspherocytes. So here, microspherocytes particularly, they have to be differentiated from the spherocytes of hereditary spherocytosis, So these microspherocytes are smaller in size than the spherocytes of hereditary spherocytosis, and they will coexist with these other shapes of schistocytes. So we have to estimate them as a percentage after counting at least 1000 red blood cells. And even a count of 1% of schistocytes is significant in adults and should prompt us to evaluate for a thrombotic microangiopathy. It can be graded as 1 plus, 2 plus or 3 plus depending upon the percentage of schistocytes. And also we have to look for if there is any other morphological abnormality on the smear. Sometimes there are other coexistent diseases such as thalassemia, sickle cell anemia, hereditary pyropoikilocytosis. In that also we can see schistocytes, but that is not primarily a fragmentation hemolytic anemia. So in that we have to give the primary diagnosis, and along with that we can mention about the schistocytes. Again, I would like to focus here on the enumeration by automated blood cell counters, which is a very useful adjunct to microscopic evaluation. So in the automated hematology analyzers, we should look for the platelet and RBC histograms. As I have already told, these schistocytes are smaller than the intact red blood cells, and they somewhat lie in the spectrum of large platelets. So somewhere in this areas, these cells will show up in these histograms. So we particularly have to look for that. Here we have an RBC histogram. We can see over here the RDW is increased. The height at the lower discriminator is abnormal and it is not touching the baseline. There is a bimodal peak, of which this peak is of the fragmented cells. There can be other causes to this kind of histogram picture, that is platelet clumps, giant platelets and microerythrocytes. So we have to go for a careful peripheral blood smear examination and find out the cause for this abnormal height. Then we have the platelet histogram. On similar lines to the RBC histogram, the platelet distribution width is increased. Here we have an abnormal height at the upper discriminator and it is not touching the baseline. Also, by impedance method, the platelets can show a spurious thrombocytosis. So in that case, it is good to look at the platelet count by optical fluorescence, which would be more accurate. Again, here also the same differentials as the RBC histogram. So look at the morphology very carefully. Also, the few automated cell counters give the fragmented red blood cell percentage and absolute count as a research parameter by fluorescence flow cytometry method in the reticulocyte channel. We can see the graph over here. It is the area below the RBC area, because they have less side scatter and forward scatter as compared to the normal RBCs. So now that you have done your CBC, the other test you should look very carefully at is the coagulogram. The importance of a coagulogram in a fragmentation hemolytic anemia cannot be emphasized on enough. I have a case coming up which will highlight that. Then the biochemical test, serum haptoglobin, it would be reduced. Serum bilirubin, there would be unconjugated hyperbilirubinemia. The serum LDH will be raised. Then we look at the LFT-RFT, which can give us clues to the specific etiologies. Other tests we can do is we can test for hemoglobinemia and hemoglobinuria by the peroxidase method, and hemosiderinuria by the Pearl's reaction. So depending upon this battery of tests, we will go for special tests depending on what we get in these tests and what kind of history we are getting. So with that, with this basic information, I come to my first syndrome, which is HUS-TTP. I will be discussing them together. So HUS, as we know, there is a characteristic triad of hemolytic anemia, thrombocytopenia and uremia. And on the other hand, TTP, it presents as a pentad of signs and symptoms, which includes neurological symptoms and fever, in addition to the triad of HUS. Although their etiology, their pathogenesis is quite diverse, and it is very important to differentiate between these two syndromes. So for this, I have a case. So we have a 4-year-old male child who presented with fever, vomiting, anuria, and a single episode of seizures. So as I have already told, that triad and pentad, there can be quite overlapping signs and symptoms in the patients, because HUS also ultimately it can progress to multi-organ failure, and same with TTP. So now this patient has a very distinct past history. There is fever and vomiting and bloody diarrhea, a single episode 1 month back. So this is a very important history. I will be coming back to this. And on examination, there is pallor, anasarca, and hypertension. So this is the CBC of this child. We can see that the hemoglobin, it is reduced to 5.6 gram per deciliter. And the platelet count is 24,000, and there is reticulocytosis. So our counter has flagged for fragments, and here we can see in this graph that the platelet graph is showing an increased height at the upper discriminator, and it is not touching for a baseline. So such kind of picture should prompt you to do a peripheral blood smear examination. And here is the peripheral blood smear. We can see on the peripheral blood smear there are numerous schistocytes that are highlighted by these red arrows, and there is also this nucleated RBC along with thrombocytopenia. We can barely see any platelet. So with this hemogram finding, we have a couple of differentials. That is HUS, TTP, is it a case of DIC, or is it some other cause of TMS? So how will we work up this child, and what kind of tests we should do? So for that, I will be first discussing these causes in detail, and then coming back to this case. So first we have HUS. As I have already told, it is characterized by renal microangiopathy, microangiopathic hemolytic anemia, and thrombocytopenia. So there are a variety of causes of HUS. It can be an infection-induced HUS, which can be a streptococcal pneumonia-associated HUS, sugar toxin E. coli HUS, or caused by other infections such as influenza A, H1N1, and HIV. So this is the typical HUS. And then there is the atypical spectrum, which can be caused by cobalamin C defects, DGKE HUS, and HUS with dysregulation of the complement alternate pathway. Then last, we have HUS with coexisting diseases or conditions. So whenever we are taking a history in these fragmentation hemolytic anemias, it should be very thorough. and we should know the past history and history of drugs very nicely. So first of all, the sugar toxin associated HUS, it is the most common cause of HUS, of the causes that I have already told, and it is also the most common cause of acute renal failure in children. So here I want to emphasize that HUS is the most common cause of fragmentation hemolytic anemia in children, and renal symptoms are predominantly seen in HUS as compared to TTP. So the sugar toxin associated HUS, it is secondary to infection with E. coli, and there will be a classical history of diarrhea to 120 days back, and a history of bloody diarrhea. So the pathogenesis, this sugar toxin that is released causes direct endothelial damage to the vascular endothelium. It elicits an inflammatory response, causes ribotoxic stress, leads to thrombocyte activation and alternative complement pathway activation. So basically this thrombocyte activation causes shear stress and leads to fragmentation of RBC, and cumulatively this leads to organ damage, particularly in the kidneys, and it can later on progress to the other organs as well. Then there is HUS associated with streptococcal infection. It is less common than that than the sugar toxin associated HUS, and more or less common after the pneumococcal vaccine has been introduced. So it is more and it is more frequent in adults nowadays. So it can be seen as a rare complication of invasive infections with streptococcal pneumonia in children, that is complicated pneumococcal pneumonia or meningitis, and a diarrhea prodrome is rarely observed. So if we compare the sugar toxin associated HUS and the streptococcal infection associated HUS, diarrhea is a differentiating factor, and also the fact that streptococcal infection associated HUS is now less commonly seen in children due to vaccination. So the pathophysiology again is similar. Here the bacterial neuraminidase is the culprit, and it exposes the T antigen against which IgM in the serum reacts, causing hemolysis, thrombocytopenia and renal damage. Then after the spectrum of typical HUS, there is atypical HUS, which is less common than typical HUS. However, it has a worse outcome. Again, it affects all ages, from children to adults. In adults, it can be triggered by some infection. There can be family history, and it can present as recurrent episodes of HUS. So, as I already said, it can be triggered by some kind of infection. So they can be diarrhea before this atypical HUS also. So on clinical history, it can be difficult to tell them separately. So what is the etiology and pathogenesis? There are mutation in the complement regulatory proteins. So their increased activity leads to these endothelial damage, and ultimately leads to RBC fragmentation and organ damage. So these mutations occur in varying proportions, of which common are the factor 8, factor H mutations, factor I mutations, the C3 mutations and the factor B mutations. Less common are thrombomodulin mutations and membrane cofactor protein mutations, factor H antibodies. So now that we know the spectrum of typical and atypical HUS, the lab features are quite similar. There is thrombocytopenia and hemolysis. So if it is after an infection or bloody diarrhea, the thrombocytopenia and hemolysis will be there before, and the renal failure will occur subsequently. The coagulation we have to look for, PT, APTT are normal or minimally prolonged, and the plasma fibrinogen is normal or elevated, and fibrin degradation products may be moderately elevated. Specifically look for the renal function test, the blood urea nitrogen and serum creatinine will be high, and the urine will show us an active sediment. There will be, there can be hemoglobin, hemosiderin, albumin. Microscopically, we can appreciate erythrocytes, leukocytes, and casts. So, with these basic tests, now we have to identify what is the specific etiology. So, we if we have a child, then our first possibility is always HUS. And in that also, our first possibility is Shiga toxin E. coli associated HUS. So, apart from the basic CBC and biochemical tests, we have to go for a stool culture for Shiga toxin E. coli and PCR. Also, we can do the free E. coli O157 antigen. So, if that comes out to be positive, it is diagnosed as Shiga toxin E. coli associated HUS, and the patient is started on supportive treatment. Coming on to the less common causes. So, if the patient presents to you with a history of pneumonia or meningitis, then you send the blood CSF pleural fluid for culture for streptococcal associated HUS. You do chest radiographs and you also do a direct Coombs test. So, if anything comes out to be positive and that points out to streptococcal HUS, you start the patient on amoxicillin or third generation cephalosporins. So then the least common cause, that is atypical HUS. So here the history again, look for very carefully family history, recurrent HUS. Okay, and then all of these tests will take time. So the patient is started on supportive treatment and subsequently we keep working up for atypical HUS. To identify cobalamin defect HUS, we can do plasma homocysteine concentrations, concentrations of methyl malonic acid in urine and plasma, and sequencing. So, if something comes out to be positive, we treat it on those lines. And then we further on, we can analyze for DGKE HUS by sequencing. If even not that, then we have to look for the complements. The plasma C3, C4, CFH and CFI with or without CFB doses, the anti-CFH antibodies and mutations. So, then if something comes out to be positive, then we treat it with first line eculizumab. So, this is for children. And the less, as we can see from these pointed arrows, in children, the TTP is much less common. So, always rule out HUS first. So then TTP, as I have already told, there is a pentad of signs and symptoms of this. Neurological abnormalities are very important in this. So in HUS, the renal abnormalities are more pronounced, and in TTP, the neurological abnormalities are more pronounced. So this is relatively uncommon before 20 years. Okay, so children, think of HUS first. Adults, think of TTP first. It's not like it cannot be otherwise, but it's just a diagnostic algorithm along with the clinical features that you have to follow, and it will bring you to the diagnosis. It is more common in females, and there are a variety of risk factors such as African ancestry, obesity, late pregnancy or peripartum period. So, what is the pathogenesis of TTP? So, this molecule, ADAMTS-13, it is a von Willebrand factor cleaving protease. It cleaves the ultra-large von Willebrand multimers into circulating normal von Willebrand factor multimers. So, if this enzyme is deficient, that is, it is less than 10%, then these ultra-large multimers won't be cleaved and they will circulate in the circulation. Ultimately, they will bind to the endothelium and act as a thrombogenic focus. So, these thrombi will cause shear stress, lead to fragmentation and ultimately tissue ischemia and the various manifestations of TTP. So, in healthy adults, the ADAMTS-13 activity ranges from 40 to 140%, and it can be reduced in certain physiological and pathological conditions such as newborns, pregnancy, liver diseases, disseminated malignancy. However, usually these conditions will not cause TTP. But if there is an underlying defect in the ADAMTS-13 gene, then they can aggravate and cause TTP. So pathologically, what causes TTP? They are the inhibitory antibodies, which can be autoantibodies that inhibit ADAMTS-13 activity, or there can be non-inhibitory antibodies that mediate the clearance of ADAMTS-13 from the circulation. So ultimately, the ADAMTS activity is reduced and the thrombogenic cycle starts. So some innocuous infections in an immune susceptible person will lead to this TTP, and in a subset of cases it is unknown. Also, ticlopidine therapy and HIV are known to cause TTP. Then we have congenital TTP after acquired TTP. So this is an inherited deficiency of ADAMTS-13, which is autosomal recessive. There are inactivating mutations in the ADAMTS-13 gene. Clinically, this will present mostly in the neonatal or in the infants, and sometimes it can present in children and early teens or 20s. So how will a typical case of TTP progress? So first of all, there will be thrombocytopenia because of the thrombus formation, which would then lead to microangiopathic hemolytic anemia, then the neurological manifestations, and if not treated, there can be multi-organ failure and death. In some cases, they remain asymptomatic for some time, and suddenly they present with stroke, and a subset of them will have some atypical manifestations. So lab diagnosis. So you have an adult, you are suspecting a thrombotic microangiopathy. There are pronounced neurological symptoms. So the clinician starts the patient on therapy, because again, we can't wait for the tests because these are fulminant conditions. And they will simultaneously obtain a sample for ADAMTS-13 assays. So first of all, we'll go for ADAMTS-13 activity. If it comes out to be less than 10%, then your diagnosis is TTP. Then after that, you will go for ADAMTS-13 immunoglobulin levels. If they are positive, then it is a autoimmune TTP. However, if they come out to be negative, we follow up the patient and we look for the ADAMTS activity in remission and the anti-ADAMTS immunoglobulin during relapse. If the activity is there in remission and during relapse the immunoglobulins come out to be positive, then again it is an autoimmune TTP. Again, if the activity is detectable in remission but the IgG antibodies are always negative, then you think of an unknown mechanism. Also, if the ADAMTS activity does not increase even during remission, then you have to go for gene analysis to look for an inherited TTP. So here again, the same flowchart. Children, go for HUS testing first. Adults, rule out TTP first. So if TTP is ruled out, then you carefully look for some other coexistent disease, or you work up for streptococcal related HUS typically. And if even not that, then you think of an atypical HUS and work up for that. So coming back to this case that I had started, so this was a 4-year-old male. So this is a child. So as I have told, we work up for HUS first, predominant renal symptoms, and there is history of bloody diarrhea. So this points towards Shigatoxin E. coli associated HUS. Also, this patient has anasarca and hypertension, which are points favoring HUS. Then we saw the CBC, there was hemolytic anemia, there was thrombocytopenia. We did a coagulation profile also. So there was some, it was almost normal. The urine showed an active sediment. There were some erythrocytes and leukocytes on the urine. And the biochemical profile, the serum LDH and all, they were suggestive of hemolysis. So then we went for a PCR for E. coli, which turned out to be positive, and the ADAMTS activity was normal. So this was a case was diagnosed as hemolytic uremic syndrome. So with that, I come to my second case. I have two cases over here. I want to take up a spectrum of this syndrome I will be talking about now. So it is a 35-year-old male presented with generalized weakness and bleeding gums. So this is the hemogram. The hemoglobin is reduced to 6.5 grams per deciliter. The platelet count is 38,000. And we can see that the WBC count is raised. Here on the histogram, we see that the RBC, the height is more at the upper discriminator, and it is not touching the baseline. So on peripheral blood smear examination, we could see these schistocytes and also these atypical blasts. This ultimately turned out to be a case of acute promyelocytic leukemia. And then I have another case. There is a neonate. There is history of fever, seizures, jaundice and petechial hemorrhages over body. So somewhat features of sepsis with these petechial hemorrhages. So we did a CBC again. The hemoglobin was reduced to 11.2 gram per deciliter. The platelet count is 45,000. The reticulocyte count is increased. That is 6.30. The counter has flagged for fragments. And again, here we can see an abnormal height at the lower, at the upper discriminator of the platelet graph, which is not touching the baseline. Here again, the peripheral blood smear examination showed these numerous schistocytes. So what are the differentials that come to mind when we see these two cases? So is it a secondary TTP or HUS which was aggravated by this malignancy or sepsis? Is it a thrombotic microangiopathy primarily caused by these diseases? Or is it leukemia or sepsis induced DIC? So here we did the coagulation profile. So the PT, APTT, D-dimer all were raised and the ADAMTS activity was normal. So here I want to stress that whenever there is a fragmentation hemolytic anemia, you see schistocytes on your blood smear, always, always look at your coagulation profile very carefully. And this case was diagnosed as a disseminated intravascular coagulation, the first one secondary to APML and the second one secondary to sepsis. So disseminated intravascular coagulation, there is widespread intravascular coagulation as a result of exposure or production of procoagulants insufficiently balanced by the natural anticoagulant mechanism, and there is subsequent endogenous fibrinolysis. So this is a very important point that will help us differentiate this from HUS-TTP. So conditions that are associated with DIC are very diverse. They can be malignancies, as we saw in the first case, a variety of cardiovascular causes, hypothermia, hyperthermia, pulmonary causes such as pulmonary embolism, ARDS, severe acidosis, anaphylaxis, infection, septicemia, bacterial, viral, fungal, all can ultimately lead to DIC, acute liver disease, tissue injury secondary to trauma, surgery, necrosis, and obstetric causes, amniotic fluid emboli, placental abruption. So here in this figure, we can see that other thrombotic microangiopathies such as HUS-TTP or any other thrombotic microangiopathy and DIC, they have an overlapping spectrum. So what will help us differentiate this from these thrombotic microangiopathic anemias? So the markedly elevated fibrin degradation products, they can be a very important clue to DIC, which are not that much raised in other thrombotic microangiopathic anemias. So look for that very carefully. Here also in this figure, we can see that the activation of the coagulation system and the secondary fibrinolysis is much more pronounced in DIC than the other TMAs such as HUS and TTP. So look at your coagulation profile very carefully. So how will DIC present? They can present with a variety of bleeding syndrome, thrombosis and thromboembolism, shock and organ dysfunctions. And a variety of lab tests can be done in DIC. These will be taken up separately in a lecture subsequently in the coagulation series. So I will not be going into the detail of these. So just to name them, D-dimer, antithrombin 3, fibrinopeptide A, platelet factor 4. These are the most reliable tests. Then always look at your fibrin degradation products, platelet count. Other tests are the protamine test, waveform analysis. So this brings me to my third case. So this is now another spectrum of these microangiopathic hemolytic anemias. So this is a 35-year-old female. She presented to us in the third trimester of pregnancy. So here the focus is on pregnancy-associated microangiopathic hemolytic anemias. This patient presented with pain in the epigastric region and vomiting, and she was a known hypertensive. There is no history of fever, seizures or bleeding. So we did a CBC. Here again we can see that the hemoglobin is reduced to 5.4 gram per deciliter. The platelet count is mildly reduced, 100, and the reticulocyte count is 5.84%. Again, the counter has flagged for fragments, and we can see an abnormal height at the upper discriminator of the platelets and at the lower discriminator of the platelets. Both of them are not touching the baseline. So this is a clue to fragmentation. Then we looked at the PBF and it showed these fragmented cells. So with that, the differential diagnosis that came to our mind were HELP, very important to rule out HELP in pregnancy, eclampsia and preeclampsia. So these are the primarily pregnancy associated fragmentation hemolytic anemias. And then there are the other thrombotic disorders which can present in pregnancy also, such as TTP, HUS, DIC, and consumptive disorders such as acute fatty liver of pregnancy and other immune mediated disorders. So how do we differentiate between these is the major question. So HELP, as the name suggests, is hemolysis, elevated liver enzymes and low platelets. So we would look at the peripheral blood, the liver enzymes, the platelets. Eclampsia, preeclampsia, there would be a very specific history. And the thing to look out for in these both these conditions is that they will get better once the delivery is done. Within 24 to 72 hours, the patient will be in remission. Whereas for the other disorders, it is not so, and they will have their particular signs and symptoms, as I have already told for TTP and HUS, the pentad and the triad. DIC will be there with the elevated coagulation, the elevated fibrin degradation products. And for drug-induced hemolytic anemias, we have to take specific history. Acute fatty liver of pregnancy, again, there will be elevated liver enzymes. We can confuse it with HELP. But here, the elevation of liver enzymes is much less as compared to HELP. Then other connective tissue disorders and immune disorders, we have to take a good history for that to rule them out. So then, as I have discussed, we did the LFTs of the patient. The SGOT and the SGPT were markedly raised. The coagulation profile was within normal limits and the RFTs were within normal limits. And this patient improved after delivery. With these points, the diagnosis of HELP syndrome was made. So help, the incidence of help is 0.1 to 0.2% of all pregnancies and in 10 to 20% women with severe preeclampsia and eclampsia. So this help, preeclampsia and eclampsia, they present as quite overlapping signs and symptoms. Characteristically, this presents in the third trimester. So this is also a final manifestation of some insult that leads to a microvascular endothelial damage, as we have seen in the other thrombotic microangiopathies. And there are a variety of risk factors. The age more than 40 or less than 18 years, they are more susceptible. If there is a previous history of HELP or preeclampsia, we have to be very careful. History of previous poor pregnancy outcome, multiparous women, multiple pregnancies, history of chronic diseases and underlying autoimmune diseases. They present with a right upper quadrant pain, generalized malaise, nausea and vomiting. And then based on the platelet count, the AST, ALT and the LDH, we can classify this HELLP syndrome under the Mississippi class syndrome system, of which the class 1 is worse and the class 1, class 3 is better. So accordingly, they are managed. So pregnancy associated TTP and HUS. So how do we differentiate HELLP from pregnancy-associated TTP and HUS? This is very important. First of all, the classical pentad and the triad, TTP is mostly seen antepartum and HUS most commonly postpartum. And the 10 to 15% of these patients can even have signs of preeclampsia. So it is difficult to distinguish them sometimes. Azotemia can be a clue to HUS. Liver enzymes to help, and the neurological symptoms can point us towards TTP, so look for them carefully. This brings me to other thrombotic microangiopathies. These were the major syndromes. And for this, I have another case. We have a 4-year-old male. The hemoglobin is reduced. The reticular count, reticulocyte count is somewhat raised. The platelet count is mildly reduced and the TLC is elevated. So we did a peripheral blood smear examination. There was monocytosis. There were some spherocytes on the peripheral blood and along with fragmented cells. So here I would like to emphasize the point that I had stated in the beginning. Always look for the coexisting abnormalities in a smear along with the fragmented cells. As I already told, the platelet count was mildly reduced and the coagulogram was within normal limits. We went back to the patient, took a history, and there was history of burns. So the diagnosis was fragmentation-induced thermal injury. So always take a good history. It will mostly point you in the right direction and tell you what you need to do. Then we have another case. This is a 60-year-old female. She presented with history of significant weight loss and weakness since 3 months. The hemoglobin, we can see this patient has severe anemia, 5.4 gram per liter, severe thrombocytopenia. And here we can see that the reticulocyte count is not that much increased. The TLC again here is increased. So we have this picture, anemia, thrombocytopenia, but the reticulocyte count is not supporting us. So what do we do now? We did a peripheral blood smear examination. There were these schistocytes. Apart from that, there were no atypical cells or any other clue to the diagnosis on the peripheral blood smear. So eventually this patient, we did a bone marrow examination and the bone marrow was almost completely replaced by these metastatic carcinomatous deposits. So this patient was a case of fragmentation hemolytic anemia secondary to a disseminated carcinoma. So disseminated carcinomas, as I've told previously, they can aggravate and cause HUS and TTP. They can themselves cause RBC shearing. They can cause increase in the ultra large von Willebrand factor. So there are a lot of causes that can lead to fragmentation hemolytic anemia in a case of disseminated carcinoma. Reticulocytosis, as was seen in this case, is usually less than that is expected in a classical fragmentation hemolytic anemia. Thrombocytopenia can be seen, they can progress to DIC, and the prognosis is poor. So this patient ultimately died just within a day of the bone marrow examination. Then there can be chemotherapy induced disease due to the direct drug induced damage to the renal endothelium and the clotting system, which is activated, leading to fibrin deposition. So if there is a patient coming from the medical oncology OPD, you can suspect that it is probably due to some drugs they are being given, such as mitomycin C, tamoxifen, a very wide variety of drugs. So it is mostly seen in those patients who are in clinical remission, and onset occurs a few weeks after last dose of chemo. So always see, but it's not necessary that the chemo is ongoing and only then you're seeing this fragmentation hemolytic anemia. Then there are transplant-associated microangiopathies. They are a form of atypical HUS. So they also lead to dysregulation of complement. So they can be seen both after solid organ and bone marrow transplant. They are fulminant, rapidly fatal diseases, present with severe renal impairment, seizures, microangiopathic hemolytic anemia, thrombocytopenia. The aggravating factors are graft versus host disease and infections. Then there is hemolysis due to immune disorders. Always take a history of an underlying immune disorder, SLE, RA. They can themselves cause destruction due to the circulating immune complexes, or they can ultimately lead to HUS or TTP. Giant hemangiomas or hemangioendotheliomas, they can cause local coagulation in the abnormal blood vessels, leading to fragmentation. And then we have March hemoglobinuria. So this is an unusual hemolytic disorder in which there is transient hemoglobinemia and hemoglobinuria in susceptible individuals after strenuous exercise that involves forceful contact of the body with hard surfaces. Typically seen in young males after prolonged marches, competitive running, or other strenuous exercises. The patient presents with dark colored urine after physical exercise, and there is not much significant anemia. So the history will tell you this, that it is a March hemoglobinuria. And it usually, the patient is in remission when this strenuous exercise and all is stopped. So last but not the least, pseudothrombotic microangiopathy. So this is basically you have a case of fragmentation hemolytic anemia, and on the smear you can see a lot of macrocytes. So is it a vitamin B12 deficiency that has caused fragmentation due to hyperhomocysteinemia, or is it the fragmentation hemolytic anemia that has led to a secondary folic acid deficiency and caused the macrocytosis? So how do we differentiate? So vitamin B12, there will be anemia with neutropenia also and thrombocytopenia. The serum bilirubin increase is not in proportion to LDH. The LDH is much more increased in fragmentation hemolytic anemia such as HUS, TTP, and the reticulocyte count before therapy, that is low, and the reticulocyte production index is low. So that is a indicator that this is a pseudothrombotic microangiopathy and not a true thrombotic microangiopathy. So my take home message is that this is a diverse group of anemias. always look for the history. Does the patient have renal symptoms? Does the patient have neurological symptoms? Is the patient taking any drug? Or is there any other history, trauma, burn, something like that? Look at your flags very carefully. They can they always point you towards the right direction. Do a careful peripheral blood smear examination. Reticulocyte count, reticulocytopenia can point you towards a pseudothrombotic microangiopathy, or okay, like I had shown that case of disseminated carcinoma, so reticulocyte count is very important. The coagulogram cannot be stressed upon enough. Always look for that. And then depending upon all this, you can go for your special tests. Thank you.
Thank you so much. The take home message is the real important part. And I think that is very important for everybody to understand that we really need to look at the flags. Wonderful lecture, Dr. Garg, ma'am. Absolutely fantastic. And just let me see if there are any questions on the YouTube. Let's please hold on, right?
Yeah, yeah. Can I stop sharing my screen?
Yeah, please stop sharing your screen.
Yeah, please. Yeah.
Yeah, we can see you, right? Let's wait and see, because there's a half a minute delay between Google Meet and YouTube.
Yes, sir.
No, there are no questions. There is just one comment, which is regarding the availability of materials on the Telegram group. Wonderful lecture, Dr. Ankita. Excellently presented. You really worked hard on that. We can see that. With the way you have compiled case-based, specific disease-based, lab-oriented, and trying to, you know, specify how to differentiate one from the other, the importance of coagulogram, and how at times a coagulogram can really put you into trouble if you don't know how to read them well. Wonderfully done.
Thank you, sir.
Like to have you back here on this platform.
Yeah, it would be a pleasure, sir.
Yeah, sure, I would. And as you know that we have a Google Drive in which all the PDF is available.
Yes.
So I would request you to please share the PDF of your lecture.
Yes.
We will upload that on the Google Drive. And we will have this YouTube lecture, you know, edited and shared with you and with everybody.
Yes, thank you. Thank you, sir.
Thank you so much. I'll get back to you with something on histopathology. I think that is also an area of your interest.
That would be great.
Yeah, that would definitely be great. Great for us as well.
Thank you. Thank you, sir. Thank you to all the listeners.
Yeah, we have quite a few people across listening, and many more will be listening to your YouTube, you know, lecture. Thank you so much. God bless you. Take care. Please share the PDF. Good night. Take care. Bye-bye. Mm-hmm. Thank you. Bye. Thank you.